Well, good morning, MLBC, and welcome to our online service this morning. Whether you're watching live or you're watching this on repeat, we're so glad that you could join with us this morning and be here today. And what a day, what a great day it is to be here today. We're going to be worshipping the Lord, and we're here, and we're just going to be soaking in His presence today. So I just want you to really lay it all down before Him this morning. Lay it all down, lay all your burdens down, lay all your cares down, all your worries down to Him. And just look to Him as we sing these songs over you today, and really just feel His presence. So we're just going to invite His presence just to come be with us right now as we sing these songs. And Lord, we're really just going to praise You and lift Your name up. So Heavenly Father, I thank You for this time that we have together this morning. I thank You that You are with us. I thank You that You love us, and I thank You that You care so much about us, even our deepest thoughts. Lord, You care all about us. And Lord, we just commit this time to You this morning and say, Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Holy Spirit, live within us. Holy Spirit, come and bring Your presence, Lord. We just want to be in Your presence this morning. No matter how we're feeling, Lord, just bring Your presence. We lay it all down before You right now and say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come and reign. Thank You, Father. Thank You that we can praise Your name. Amen. So, join in with us. If you just want to sit down and listen, that's fine. If you want to close your eyes, that's fine. If you want to just sing the words, that's fine. You are welcome to do whatever you would like to this morning as we just get into the presence of God and get into a time of worship. So God bless you.
Your glory. said to Moses, "Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. So they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them."
As Hannah read that verse, we just have the feeling that we should sing the blessing over you this morning. So that's what we're going to do.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Sing that again.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and the children and the children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning. He's coming and you're going and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you. Going
presence. Thank you that you go before us, Lord. Thank you that you're with us and you surround us. Thank you that you are ever present in our lives, Lord. And we just worship you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just lift up your thanks to him right now. Just lift up your thanks of praise right now. However you want to do it, just lift them up. Thank you, Jesus.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. Lift up your heads, O you gates, be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Amen. Just feel the Holy Spirit here. And we may be quick to move on, but I just feel that we should just linger in his presence. Yeah, we're going to sing our amens.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Our reading is found in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2 to 6. I read in Jesus' name. With all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. Amen.
I think I was about 13 or 14 when I first heard my mum utter this phrase, "I love you, but I don't like you very much at the moment, and I really need you to leave the room." It wasn't directed at me, and it wasn't said with malice or anger. It was said very calmly, as I've just shared with you. It was a Saturday afternoon, and we had had lunch. We were just settling down to watch Neris Hughes sing the alphabet. It was my sister's favourite VHS. Now, for those of you who are younger, you need to ask the adults what one of those is. Neris would sing the alphabet. My little sister adored this and would play it on repeat. It went a little bit like this. My name is A, and I say ah. Ah is for apple, ah 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 ah. My name is B, and I say buh. Buh is for balloon, buh 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 buh. And so on, through the whole alphabet. And well, as much as I just annoyed you in, I don't know, 20 seconds, this on repeat annoyed all of us. So my brother had left the room. And shortly after he left, we heard an almighty noise, a crash, a bang, a wallop. It was as if the walls were collapsing, as if the cupboards had just fallen right off with all the contents in them. See, the day before, on the Friday, we'd been to my grandparents and they'd just had fitted a brand new dishwasher. Now, I know that doesn't sound like a big deal to most of you, but in the 90s, this was a big deal. And as our treat, as children, we were allowed to load the dishwasher. So after dinner, we put the plates, the cups, the glasses, the cutlery into the dishwasher. And we're rewarded with lots of praise with an ice cream. And so that Saturday, the day after lunch, and all the cutlery and the crockery and the glasses were in the kitchen ready to be washed up, my brother thought it would be a really big help if he loaded them into the dishwasher. There was just a problem. We didn't have a dishwasher. So he had loaded them into the tumble dryer. And the noise that sounded as if the cupboards were collapsing with all the contents in was the tumble dryer full of crockery and cutlery and glasses going round and round and round. You can imagine how pleased my mum was. But when she said those words about loving him but not liking him, she really meant it. In the way that she loved him, she wasn't going to remove him. I mean, she could have just put him outside and said, off you go, Chuck. It's not what she was going to do. She was going to bear with him. But at that point, she needed us to help remove him from the room as she dealt with the aftermath and the destruction and the mess and the chaos and processed her thoughts and feelings. My brother, my sister, myself, we're human. We were kids. We annoyed her, frustrated her, disappointed her, angered her repeatedly. Mostly unintentionally, but sometimes on purpose, because we're human. And the reality of church life is not much different to that, really. It's probably not the best way to start your time with a church, but I'm going to be upfront with you. I will hurt you, disappoint you, annoy you, agitate you, frustrate you, and every other thing you can think of. Most of the time it'll be unintentional, because I'm human and flawed, because I don't know the backstories and the intricacies, because I put my foot in it and I miss say something. Some of the time though, it'll be because I have to make difficult decisions, and the things that you want or you need, I won't be able to give you, or they won't be the right things for the church as a whole. And you won't get your needs or your wants, wishes or desires met. But I promise you that I will always do my best to seek to be a bearer of God's hope and peace for you and to you. See, this passage is written to the church in Ephesus, a group of smaller groups of people meeting, a bit like, I guess, the Thursdownians. But it does know that humans are human, flawed and real. And so it reminds them to live a life worthy of the one that they have been called to by God. It calls to them to be humble, to be gentle, to be patient, and to love one another. And friends, they're good things for us to think about, particularly at this time when we're not able to meet together. I know that not meeting together means that there have been things that have been able to happen that some of you have been pleased about, and things that have been not able to happen, and that's been disappointing to everybody. But I'm really impressed with the way in which you've stayed together. See, there's gentleness in how you've treated one another, and that shines through. When we think about things like humility, I'm often mindful that it isn't thinking less of yourself, but it is about thinking of yourself less. There will be times in church life where we don't get what we want, but the humility aspect of it will enable us to see that others might get what they need. We can't all have it our way all the time. I'm never going to please 100% of the people 100% of the time. It's just not possible, because it's not even possible for God. And then there's the reality of practicing patience. Friends, life is tricky, and we all work at different paces and speeds. We all have different stories, and we all have different things going on. And so this reminder to be patient with one another, making allowances for each other's faults and failings, is a true testing. The world is quick to disconnect, to remove people, to delete people, to block people. And as the people of God, we are called to bring each other closer. Now, physically, that's a bit difficult at the moment, but what I mean is more a spiritual, metaphorical sense. To be close to one another, not just as individuals who like the same football team, but as family. For also in this passage, we're reminded that there is one God and Father of all. As my mum bared with my siblings and I on numerous occasions, she'll tell you that she still has to, we're called to bear with one another, to stick the course. We will disagree on all sorts of things. Some of them will be little things like, you know, what coffee should we have? What colour should the wall be? And others will be big things like the theology of creation or the end times. And many things in between. Things that we will hold important and dear to us will be different in my life than yours. And we're called to have unity, but that doesn't mean uniformity, friends. It's not as if when you or I encounter the Spirit that a cookie cutter comes from the sky and presses down on us so that we're all the same shape, size and thickness. It's not how it is. We encounter the same Spirit, but our encounters with God are different. Our backgrounds and stories, our experiences of God in this world are different. And so we bring those stories to us when we look at the word. We will have differences of opinions on many different things. And that doesn't mean that we can't be united. My kneecap does a different job to my little finger. And yet in scripture, we're reminded about the body of Christ that we're called to be, each with different parts. No one part is greater or has more status than the other, but all parts need to work together for the full glory of Christ to be revealed. And friends, our community needs the glory of Christ to be revealed. In a world where people are not gentle, where humility is usually the bottom of the character trait list, and where people don't practice patience, where there's a lack of love, where hope seems like a thing that we dare not dream, we're called to live differently. That doesn't mean it's going to be easy. As I said, I'm going to annoy you, frustrate you, disappoint you, hurt you. Oh, it's going to be hard. But it's what we're called to. And I am willing to have a go at loving you even when I don't like you. I wonder if you're willing to have a go at loving me, even when you don't like me. Not because of who we are, but because the reminder in this passage of who God is and what that means for each of us. See, it says, we've been called to one glorious hope for the future. For there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all and through all. The three values that Mitcham Lane Baptist Church has, which drew me to the church of loving God, loving people and loving life, can be outworked if we practice these things. If we are a humble people who are gentle and patient, who really love each other, then the others from outside the walls will see that. The church in general, not Mitcham Lane, I mean the big church of the world, doesn't have a good rap. There aren't good news stories that get shared regularly where the church does the right thing and people feel loved and honoured, worthy and given praise. Bad news sells. And so lots of people outside of the walls of the church think of church and church folk as hypocritical. They've heard the horror stories of how people have been treated. The bad news sells quicker and is louder than good news. But if we commit now, at the start of our journey together, to upholding these characteristics, we will be attractive to those in community. Because our friends outside the walls of our church are looking for places to be loved. They're desperately seeking places to be known and still loved. And I think we can offer that to them, not because of who we are, but because of who God is and who we are called to be in his name. Friends, how this week will you practice humility, gentleness, patience and love to one another? I look forward to hearing how you've worked that out this week. Drop me a message. You can get hold of me via the church Facebook, or you can email me. My email has been circulated, but if you've got any problems at all, contact the office. I can't promise you that you will always like me, but friends, I hope that you will always love me, for I can't promise that I will always like you, but I promise deep, deep, deep within my heart that I will do my utter best to love you as we work on this together, as the people that God calls us to be for such a time as this.
Good morning, church. Tonight the leadership team meets at 7:30. This is going to be Gemma's first meeting in charge of the leadership team, and it's very important that we gel together. So please pray for that, and also for wisdom and guidance as we discuss a number of important matters. Next Sunday will be the church meeting at 11:30. This of course is for church members only, and it's a privilege and a responsibility to be at church meetings, so please come if you possibly can. And finally, a reminder that the deadline for voting in the leadership elections is on Thursday. We have one nomination, Janet Morgan Smith, and this is your opportunity to indicate whether or not you want Janet to join the leadership team. So please don't miss the deadline. God bless you all.
Thank you so much for joining in our service today. If you want to speak to us a little bit more, then we'll be on Zoom after this service. So come over there and perhaps meet some of us, have a bit of a chat. And you're invited to come and join us back here on YouTube next week for another service. Take care and have a good week.